What happened to that? I don't know what happened to that. Our theme for this next few Sundays is desiring. But that is incomplete. It's desiring God's desire. I don't know what happened with that, but it's desiring God's desire. It means pursuing God's desire with joy and great delight. And we see this in the text that we will talk about for the next few Sundays. And this text, this passage, is actually a continuation of where we left last Sunday. Thank you, Brother Leo, for concluding that spiritual blessings in Christ last Sunday. And indeed, we are so blessed. Tell your statement, you are so blessed. You are so blessed. God has blessed you with every spiritual blessings in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. God has chosen you. God has predestined you to be adopted as His sons and daughters. God has redeemed you by His blood. Can you imagine that? God has shown you that, made you know the mystery of His will. God has worked out everything so you can believe God. It's all God's grace. It's all God's work in our lives. And you were marked with Him in a seal last Sunday. You heard the preaching. You were marked with Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. God being. Wow. That's the word we talk about in our Bible study life on last Friday. Guaranteeing is that sounds so secure in Christ. You are secure in Christ. Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ. Nothing can snatch you out of the hand of God, of Jesus. You are so secure because you are sealed by the promised Holy Spirit, guaranteeing your inheritance in Christ. So we are so blessed, amen. We're so blessed in Christ. And Paul shows us. There you go. What happened to that? Take one. Wait a minute. And Apostle Paul shows us the appropriate response to this spiritual blessing. If you open your Bible in Ephesians chapter 1, in verse 3 says, "Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." That's the appropriate response. You know? And we know that. We can relate to that because every time we receive blessing, yes, verse is a bang, well done. You know, I'm sure when you read the notice or email, you're jumping in joy. Oh, praise God! Please pray for my voice because I might lose my voice. But by the grace of God, we will survive. When we receive blessing, when we receive an answer to our prayers, amen. We praise God. Thank you, Lord, you're so good. Amen. When God protects you, when God protects your children, when God gives you a special gift, amen. Yes, Sister Lizelle, you might have a very special gift, amen. And coming soon, like Sister Leia and Sister Rosel coming soon. Another apostle for Brother Elmer is coming soon. Wow, these are special gifts. And Ami is coming soon too. These are special gifts. I'm sure when you have found the news, right, Rosel? When you found the news, praise God. Thank you. So that's the same thing with Apostle Paul. The apostle was praising God and given in verse 15 to 23, Paul continues to praise God. Look at this. This is the text that we're going to talk about today. Oh, that's why. What happened? Who did that? Are you trying to make my slide more fancy? Thank you. Verse 15 to 17. "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ." This is the continuation of the spiritual blessings, all right? Just to make sure that we understand this. There is a flow here. There is a continuity here. Paul is saying, "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers." Now, the Apostle Paul recounting and listing all the spiritual blessings for the church, for every Christian, and seeing the condition of the church in Ephesus, he was saying, I never stop giving thanks. See, the church in Ephesus, they are doing well in the church. They are like the Corinthian church where there's so much, you know, immorality problem, so much, division problem. But the Ephesians church, they are doing well. So the apostle is saying, I never stop giving thanks because you have faith in Christ and you never stop loving the saints. And so when you think about that, you know, Paul would have just stopped right there. You know, everything is good, everything is well. Just like when we receive blessing, we just want to thank God. Right? Thank you, Lord, that's it. But Paul here, look at this. Paul here continues to pray for the church because he knows that there is something more than just receiving the blessing. That there's something more than just thanking God, thank you, Lord, and praise God for the blessing. There is something more that the Apostle Paul doesn't want the Christians, the church, to miss. And I believe we should hear it today. Because I think we're also missing this point. You know, every time we receive the blessing, we praise God and just stop there. You know, God answers our prayer, thank you, Lord, and stop there. You know, God made a miracle, God heals you. Thank you, Lord, I'm healed. Just stop there. Thank you, Lord, I have a peace. Thank you, Lord. We just stop there. But the Apostle Paul knows that there is something more. There is something more than just thanking God and praising God. And this is the prayer of the Apostle Paul. He's saying, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Look at this. So that you may know Him better. There's every reason why God does something good to us. There's every reason, there's a higher reason, I would say, or deeper reason, why God blesses us with every spiritual blessing in Christ. It's not just to for us to respond, thank you, Lord, and praise God. God desires something far greater and far more glorious than just us saying, thank you, Lord. That's good that we thank God. You know, we're not saying that we should not. We should always give thanks, we should always give praise. But we should not stop there, because there is something more beautiful beyond the giving of thanks and giving of praise. And the Apostle Paul is aware of that. And what is that? So that you may know Him better. That's what I want to share with you today. Keep asking God to know Christ better. Would you say that to your seat, mate? Keep asking God to know Christ better. Amen? Keep asking God. That's what the Apostle Paul is doing. I keep asking God that you may know Christ better. All right? Now, you all have to raise your hand here, but let's develop this question. How many of us pray that prayer of Paul, that I may know Christ better? How many of us keep asking God, Lord, I want to know You more. I want to know Jesus better. How many of us pray that prayer for our spouse? How many of us pray that prayer for your children? How many of us pray that prayer regularly, daily? Lord, I want to know Christ better. My guess is that not most of us do. In my years of ministry, I just can't recall receiving a prayer request that says, Pastor, would you pray that I may know Christ more? Or, Pastor, would you pray for that my family, my spouse, my wife, my husband will know Christ more? Now, that doesn't mean we don't desire this. I believe we do. Amen? I believe we do. I believe every one of us have that desire to know Christ better. Amen? That's why we continually study the Word of God. That's why we continually hear the preaching of the Word. That's why we just don't need to do our devotion. We want to know Christ better. However, if we don't pray this prayer, if we don't have, if we keep asking God for this, you know what happens? If we're not aware of this, when, again, I say, when blessings come, we stop there. God's desire in showering us with His blessings, God's desire is for us to know Christ better, doesn't happen because we stop right there. Now, why should we do this? Why should we keep asking God to know Christ better? Let me share to you several good reasons. First, keep asking God to know Christ better because there is so much more of Christ than you could ever know. Let me admit that. We ask God that we might know Christ better because there's so much more of Christ than you could ever know. See, the Christians at Ephesus, as I said, they are already doing well. They have their faith in Christ, and that faith produces love and good works. That's an excellent Christianity. They're doing well. But Paul was saying, I keep asking God that you might know Christ better. Meaning the Apostle Paul was never contented. He knows there's so much more to experience of Christ than they know, than they have experienced. And I believe it's so with us, amen? How many of you have known the Lord for 1 year or 5 years? Would you raise your hand within that 5 year period? Amen? How many have known the Lord for 10 years within that period? 10 years? 10 years? 20 years? Well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. How about the rest? You have known? 20 years? More than 50? 29 years? Wow! Wow! See, whatever our conditions, maybe you have known the Lord last month or last year. You can be a baby in the Lord, or you could be with the Lord for a long time of year already. But the same holds true. The same holds true. There is so much more of Christ that you could ever know. That means we can never reach a place, we can never reach a position or a time where we can say, hey, I have known the Lord enough. Or I have read the Bible enough. I don't need to read more of the Bible. I don't need to listen to the preaching anymore because I have known the Lord enough. No one can say that. No one. Because there's so much more of Christ than what you could ever know. We are all in the same boat here, whether 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. There's so much more of Christ than we could ever know. Consider these verses. In 1 Corinthians 1, 24, it says that Christ is the power of God and Christ is the wisdom of God. Now, think about this. Christ is the power of God and Christ is the wisdom of God. Now, can anyone say, I fully discovered the power of God? Can anyone say that? Christ is the wisdom of God. Can any one of us say, I have reached the depths? I have fathomed the depths of the wisdom of Christ. Can anyone say that? I don't think so, right? I don't think so. In fact, if we would just be honest, all of us, we can say we're just scratching the surface of Christ. We're simply scratching the surface. There's so much more of Christ than we could ever know. That's why we need to keep asking God, God, I want to know Christ better. Romans 11:33-34 says, all the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable is judgment, his paths beyond tracing out, who has known the mind of the Lord, who has been his counselor. Consider Hebrews 1:3, says the Son is the radiance of God's glory. Jesus Christ is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. Again, who can fully grasp, who can fully see the fullness of the radiance of Jesus Christ? Lastly, consider Isaiah 55:8-9. It says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. What do we see? What do we see here? We see here that Christ is supremely and infinitely great. Amen? In glory, in wisdom, in power, he is infinitely, immeasurably supreme. While us, we are so finite, our minds are so finite, right? We can never reach a place, a time where we can say, I have known Jesus, and I don't need to know him anymore. Moses, while leading Israel to the promised land, Moses saw the power of God, right? Bringing Pharaoh down, bringing Egypt down, bringing all the plagues, all the power of God. Moses had seen that. And Moses recognized that this is favor of God. He knows that. And God just continued to affirm, I am pleased with you, Moses. I am pleased with you. And you know what Moses said to God? And God said, I am pleased with you. Moses said, if you are pleased with me, he said, show me your glory. Show me your glory. Moses understood, Moses knew that there is so much more than just seeing miracles, than just seeing the power of God in the lives of the people, that seeing the power of God saving them from the darkness of Egypt. There is so much more, and that's why his prayer is, Lord God, I want to see more of your glory. Because there's so much more of Christ than we could ever know. That question, my friends, the question that we can ask ourselves, are we like Moses? Are we like Paul, desperate to know more of Christ? Know that there's so much more of Christ that we want to know him more. Know Christ better. Amen. If we do know that, the Apostle Paul is telling us, follow me, imitate me. Keep asking God. Don't stop. Keep asking God every day. Keep asking the Lord, I want to know you more. Lord Jesus, I want to know you better. Because that's your desire for me, and I'm desiring your desire. Second reason why we should keep asking God to know Christ better is this, because knowing Christ is what matters. Knowing Christ in this life is what matters. Do you want to know what you value in life? Do you want to know what is important to you? You want to know what matters to you? Listen to your prayers. If you're praying, listen to your prayers. Tonight, when you pray before you sleep, amen? Right? Tonight, before you sleep, when you pray, listen to your prayers. What are you praying about? Because what you pray about matters to you, amen? If you pray about the salvation of your family, that matters to you. If you pray that your husband will change, to you. If you pray that your wife will change, that matters to you. If you pray for your protection of your family, that matters to you. Amen? Now, Paul is telling us here that knowing Christ, because he keeps asking God, he keeps asking God that the church, Christians in Ephesus would know Christ better. For the apostle, that's what matters. That's what matters to God, and that what matters to the church, to every Christian in Ephesus. Now, why does it matter? We ask. Why does it matter? Why should we pray for this? Lord, I want to know you, Lord, more, to know Christ better. Why should this matter? Now, there's a parallel passage in Colossians 1, 9 to 10. When we say about parallel passage, that means that the passage that we have studied in Ephesians 1 is almost parallel, almost the same. And you will see this in Colossians 1, 9 to 10. This is what he's saying. For this reason, the same thing, isn't it? In Ephesians 1, 15, for this reason, right? The same thing. Since the day we have heard of you, the same thing in Ephesians 1, since the day we heard you, we have not stopped praying for you, the same thing, and asking God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God. There is that parallelism. And in Colossians 1, here we discover Paul is telling us more what is contained in knowing Christ better. What happens when you grow in the knowledge of God? What happens when you know Christ better? Three things happen. You live a life worthy of the Lord. You please Him in every way. You bear fruit in every good work. What does it mean? What does it mean? It means that when you come to know Christ better, your life will change. Sabihin niyo po sa katabi niyo, your life will change if you know Christ better. Yes! The radical change will happen in our lives is proportionate with our knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I will tell you what is that knowledge of Christ. It's not just knowing about Christ. It's not just information, but there's more to that. Amen? Which means, when you come to know Christ, when you live a life worthy of the Lord, when you please Him in every way, when you bear fruit in every good work, this change happens. Your conviction will become stronger. Your convictions. Not what I mean by convictions, amen? Amen? We all have convictions. But sometimes our convictions are weak. For example, your conviction that lying is sin. You know that you have that conviction. But it is so weak. So what happens? When you are pressed in the corner, right? You are forced to lie. You still lie because your conviction is weak. Now when you know Christ better, that conviction gets stronger. Amen? When you know Christ better, your love for Jesus goes deeper. Say deeper. How is your love for Jesus? Is it deeper? Is it becoming more deeper? I know we all love Jesus, amen? Those who love Jesus, say amen. 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 But again, it is proportionate. It depends on how we know Christ. The more we know Christ better, this love for Jesus goes deeper. The joy of the Lord in us goes deeper. I know we rejoice in God, but joy can go deeper when you know Christ better. So this is a change that happens when you come to know Christ better. This is the experience of Moses again. You know Moses, right? Moses was raised in the palace of Egypt. You know that story, right? Moses enjoyed all the riches, all the treasure, all the happenings, all the parties, all the food, all the expensive clothes. Moses enjoyed that. He was known to be the son of the Pharaoh's daughter. Amen. And so all the benefits of being in the palace, Moses is enjoying it. But look at here. In Hebrews 11, 24, 26, read it here. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, look at this, he refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Wow. Can you imagine that? Moses, who'd been enjoying the treasure and riches and all the benefits of being in the palace, he refused. Second, he chose to be mistreated along with the people of God. Rather than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a short time, he regarded this grace of greater value than the treasures of Egypt. Why? Why is that? What is the reason? What is the reason? Why would Moses refuse to be the son of the Pharaoh's daughter? Why would he choose to be mistreated? Why would he choose to leave all the comforts and all the riches and all the treasures of Egypt? Why? Because it says there, for the sake of Christ. For the sake of Christ. Of course, Christ was not yet there physically, but Moses had that revelation of Jesus Christ. Moses already at that time had a knowledge of who Jesus is. And the faith in Christ himself. He refused to be the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated. He chose to leave the joy of and the pleasure of sin. Why? Because he looked forward to a better reward. Moses knows better. Moses knows Christ better. Conviction becomes stronger. Love for Jesus becomes deeper. The joy of the Lord becomes deeper. I know someone, a friend of mine in the U.S. She's an accountant. And you know what accountants do, right? They prepare books and all that, records. And she was telling me there was a time when her boss told her to manipulate something in the record. And you know what that means, to manipulate something, you know, so that the books would look good, all that. But she's a Christian, and her conviction is strong. Her love for Jesus is deep. And she knows. By the way, when her boss told her, if you don't do this, you'll be fired. Now, let us place our feet in our shoes. If that is us, you know, you're given an option. You know, you want to maintain your job, Brother Alex, and boss tell you, but you have to lie. What do you choose? You want to keep your job, Michael, but you have to compromise. What will you choose? This sister of ours had a choice. She refused. She was fired. But the Lord was faithful the Lord gave her even a better gift. Because she knows Christ better. Her conviction is stronger. Her love for Jesus is deeper. Because she knows Christ better. On our way here, back from Manila to Manila to Vancouver first. After our dinner, suddenly we heard an announcement from the plane. They're looking for a medical practitioner because someone is sick on the plane. So when Sister Ken and I heard that, we just paused for a while. We prayed for that person. Father, whoever that is, we just pray for your healing in Jesus' name. We pray. And suddenly, all the people are like having a commotion. People are looking. The person was all the way in our back, and we're looking at the back. And I felt a tug in my heart. I felt a still small voice in my heart telling me, go to that person and pray for that person. I can almost, I don't hear the audible voice, but a still small voice, that's kind of like in your heart. I try to ignore it, I try to, because after all, we prayed already, right? But the conviction and that still small voice becomes stronger and stronger. It's stronger in your heart. And a couple of people are surrounding that person. But I made a choice. I stood up and go to that place where the person was. And I saw but that person was so pale. That pale marketing kid, it's so pale. And she was so in pain, holding her stomach. And the stewardess and doctor asked, how are you? I cannot breathe, so I was there. But I cannot breathe because the doctor is there. And the stewardess are surrounding the person. So I just stand by for a while, looking. And I know the Lord wants me to pray for that person, not praying here, but praying there. I really felt that way. So I waited till the doctor, left the person, and I had a chance. So, for example, Sister Ed was the person. I immediately sneak in and say, I just asked for permission. Can I pray for you? I said, yes, you know. I prayed a very simple prayer. I just said, Father, I lay hand on him and on his throne. But Father, in the name of Jesus, heal this person. That's it. Not so much. Just a simple prayer. I just left. Okay, see you later. And I came back to my seat. After a while, I came back because I need to go to the washroom. And he's sitting beside me. The washroom. I just saw him. He's back to normal. He's back to normal. I said, "Kumusta na ang Pilipino?" I said, "How are you?" He said, "When I was praying for him, his eyes is closed. His eyes is he didn't even see me." And I said, "Kumusta ka na?" He told me, "Thank you for praying for me." And I said, "It is the Lord will you. It is the Lord will you." Why am I testifying this? It's not for me to get glory. What I'm saying is this. Because in my past, I had those times when I have struggled in praying publicly. Anyone can believe? We have problem, struggle in praying publicly. I can tell that sometimes I tell someone, "Would you pray for the offering?" Pastor, pray for the offering, Pastor. We all have struggle. I have those struggles. I remember a time, I'll be quick on this. I remember a time I visited an old woman, an old lady who is sick. I was there face to face. And there was, again, there was a tug in my heart to pray. But I was consumed by I was ashamed to pray. I was thinking, what would this lady, you know, say if I pray for her? So I didn't pray. I left the place. I didn't pray. The worst thing that happened is this. After 2 or 3 days, I learned that old woman died. Sadly, God was so devastated. I had a chance. I just had there. I could just say, can I pray for you? I could have encouraged her. I could have shared the gospel. I was so controlled by fear. I was unable to. I was also invited to pray for a closing prayer for a concert. You know, a concert, a huge public, many people are there. But again, I don't know. Because sometimes I have an experience that when I pray, sometimes my mind gets blank. You experience that? You know, I fear, I'm just ruined the concert. Right. So I was scared to, I have something to do, but the thing is, I was afraid. When we know Christ better, our love for Jesus grows deeper. Now you would want to honor God in all things, at all times, whatever people may say, the desire of your heart is simply to honor Christ because you know Him better. No more fear of men. No more fear of rejection. Because when you know Christ better, you would want to honor Him because your love for Him grows. Thirdly, lastly, keep asking God to know Christ better, because it is the work of God's grace. Say, it is the work of God's grace. But Paul is saying, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. You can only know Christ better if God gives you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. That's what we need to know Christ better. We can't do this on our own. This is the work of God. This is the work of grace in our lives, that we would come to know Christ better. God has poured out His spirit of wisdom and revelation. Now, I talked about information. Wisdom and revelation is totally different from information. Information cannot make you love Jesus more. Information cannot make your conviction grow stronger. Cannot. It has the wisdom and revelation. You may read the Bible cover to cover. You may know all the Bible facts, all the Bible characters, places and times. You may read and know about all the miracles that Jesus did. But without wisdom and revelation, those knowledge is just information. You may know that Christ was born by a virgin birth. You may know that Jesus died on the cross on Good Friday and rose up on Easter Sunday. But without wisdom and revelation, those knowledge is just information. Those information cannot change you. Those information cannot bring stronger conviction, and you cannot have your love for God deeper. You may know, you may have heard all the spiritual blessings. We preach that for 4 or 5 Sundays. You have known that. Question is, was there wisdom? Have you received the wisdom and revelation? Because if not, those are just knowledge. It didn't change you at all. You may have heard it. You may have heard the pastors, your preachers, you passionately preaching about, you know, you were chosen before the creation of the world. You're predestined to be adopted as His sons. You know, you were redeemed by His blood. You have hope in Christ. You were sealed by the Holy Spirit, guaranteeing the promise of your inheritance. But without wisdom and revelation, it's just knowledge. Your love for Jesus didn't go deeper. You're not changed. You know information more, but it didn't change you. You remain the same person. Now, how does wisdom? By the way, wisdom in Greek is Sophia. Where is Sophia? That's wisdom. It means the capacity to understand and to act. That's wisdom. There is that capacity to understand and revelation in Greek is apokalypsis, which means to fully know. To fully know, to reveal, to fully know what is hidden. Right? When it is hidden, it's not revealed. When it's revealed, you fully know. That's what we need to know Christ better. We need the Spirit to give us wisdom and revelation. How does that happen? The Spirit works through the Word of God. The Spirit used the Word of God to give us wisdom and revelation. The Word of God is life and is lips. The psalmist David is saying, "Thy word is a lamp to my feet and light to my path." Meaning, when the Word of God gives you a revelation and wisdom, you know where you are. You know where you're going. You know who you are. You know who. You know your Father. You know your Savior. You know your Jesus. When you have those wisdom and revelation. Let me close this message with a story of a parable which we already know this, but just to illustrate the point. There are two persons in the temple. One is a Pharisee and one is a tax collector. They're praying side by side, and the Pharisee prayed, lifting his hands, and look, God, thank you that I'm not like this person. I'm not a robber, I'm not a thief, I'm not an adulterer, I'm not evil doer. You know, and I, you know, God, I thank you that, you know, I give my tithes, you know, my tithe to you. I give everything to you. He was so boastful of what he has achieved. The tax collector prayed. He could not even look up to heaven. He was beating his chest. He was saying, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you, church, I tell you, my friends, this tax collector received wisdom and revelation. He knew that God is merciful. He knew that he is a sinner. My friends, the moment you recognize you are a sinner, it is a revelation from the Holy Spirit. Not too many people will acknowledge that they are sinners. Not too many people will acknowledge their need for God. This Pharisee never acknowledged his need for God. He was saying, I'm doing this. You know, I've given everything to you. I'm giving my tithes and everything to you. I'm not like that person. I am good. I am righteous. That's not a revelation from the Spirit. That's not a wisdom from God. The wisdom and revelation of God gives you the understanding of who God is, of who Jesus is, of what God's will is, of what God's ways are. And when you have that wisdom, you have the capacity to understand and to act. You act today. You act. I pray today that as we hear this message, that somehow the Lord, the Holy Spirit, will move us to desire God's desire. God's desire for all of us is that we may know Christ better. God's desire for us is that our lives will change. God's desire for us is that we would live a life worthy of the Lord, pleasing Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work. But that will happen if we will keep on asking God. Because keep asking God for this means you are desiring it. You want to pursue it. You want it. I want it, Lord. I want it. I want to honor you in my life. I want to glorify you in my life. I want to please you in every way in my life. I want it, Lord. I want so please give me the spirit of wisdom and revelation. I don't know what your conditions are today in the Lord. But I just want to bring this challenge to all of us, including myself. We are in this together. This journey of knowing Christ better, we are in this together. But I want to challenge all of us. Let's ask ourselves today, what do we pursue in this life? What do we want to have in this life? What do you dream about? What makes you awake at night? What do you want to have in your family, in your life? Will it be to have a comfortable life? Will it be to have more riches, more money in the bank, more of this, more of that? Will it be to be more, more popular, more acceptable in your work, in whatever? What do you desire? I pray today that the Word of God, that the Spirit who gives wisdom and revelation will somehow reveal it to you. That the most important thing in this life is not riches, not success, not prosperity, not even good health. The most important thing is knowing Christ better. That's the most important thing. And when we have that desire, whatever we go through in life, my friends, whatever we go, in blessings, you will not drift away. You will not forget God. When there are blessings, we praise God. At the same time, we know Christ better. But also when you go to trials and problems and troubles, you don't just pray, Lord, take me out of this trouble. Your desire is to know Him, to experience the grace of God in times of trouble. That's the most important thing. And that's why the Apostle Paul was saying, he was praying that God would take on the thorn in his flesh, and God said, no, you will have a thorn in your flesh. And he said, okay, God's grace is sufficient for me. Now I take delight in every insult, in every weakness, in every difficulty. Why? For the sake of Christ, so that I could experience the grace of God in Jesus Christ. That's the desire of God to all of us. That's the desire of God. And when we keep asking God to know Christ better, you can be assured of this. That's the prayer that God will answer. I can assure you this. That's the prayer that God will answer. So I challenge you, pray that prayer, amen? Pray that prayer. I want to know Christ better. I want to know Christ better. Let it be the desire of your hearts every day.